Good morning. I would like to welcome you here to Bethel this morning, and we are so glad that you are here with us for worship. As we direct our hearts and our thoughts toward the Lord this morning in worship, listen to a portion of Psalm 27 this morning. David writes and says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When evildoers assail me to eat up my flesh, my adversaries and foes, it is they who stumble and fall. Though an army encamp around me, my heart shall not fear. Though war arise against me, yet I will be confident. One thing I have asked of the Lord, that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. Hear, O Lord, when I cry aloud, be gracious to me and answer me. You have said, seek my face." The Lord says, seek his face. "My heart says to you, your face, Lord, do I seek." I don't know about you, but sometimes it's easier to seek the Lord's hand than his face. We're going to hear a lot more about that in our text today in John. So let's just go to the Lord and pray this morning and just ask that the Holy Spirit would help us seek the face of the Lord and the face of Jesus Christ today, and not just his activity and his work in our lives. God, I thank you so very much for the opportunity that we have to worship you here today. God, I thank you that your word promises that when believers gather in your name to worship, that you are there present with them. God, I thank you that not only are you here, but your Holy Spirit is here as well. So God, we ask that your Holy Spirit would be mighty and strong here today at Bethel, that you would be glorified, God, through our worship, the songs that we sing, the prayers that are prayed, gifts that are given. Lord, through our time and your word, I pray that you would be glorified. I pray that Jesus would be exalted and lifted up. God, I ask that through the power of your Spirit and the power of your word, our hearts would be transformed as we worship you here today. That God, you would make us more and more into the likeness of your Son so that we can reflect him in all that we do and say, and that we can faithfully follow you in all the steps of our lives. God, we ask that you would be glorified and pleased with our worship today. Holy Spirit, speak and move here in our midst, all for God's glory and the fame of Jesus. We pray. Amen.
So my peers here, we are in a band at Branch Christian Academy off of Union Street, and we have been working on some songs, and we're going to play an original for you today. But we're going to start off with "We Fall Down." I think that's one that everybody knows, and I would enjoy it if you sing along with us.
At the feet of Jesus, we fall down.
Thank you that your word tells us that you are good. You are always faithful. God, you are powerful and mighty. You are strong. God, there are many times and circumstances that we face in life, God, that we're unsure of, that are beyond our control. Lord, they are difficult, hard. We try to make sense of them all. But God, I thank you that as we cling to the promises and truth in your word, we don't have to make sense of them because, God, you have a plan. And we know that your word tells us that you are mighty, that you are faithful. So, God, I pray that when our eyes might deceive us, when our hearts and our feelings might deceive us, that, God, we would run to your word and that we would hold to the truth in your word, knowing that, God, you are good, that you have a plan. God, as we look to our world around us, there are many needs. There are needs within our congregation. There are needs within our own lives, our own families. God, there are needs in our community, in our nation, in our world. But God, I'm thankful that no matter how great our need, you are always sufficient. God, I pray that you would grow here at Bethel, just a faith family that reflects Jesus and faithfully follows you in all that we do and say. God, I also want to pray for our sister church, First Baptist Oakboro, and Pastor Jonathan. God, I pray that you would just do a great work there at their church, Lord, that Jesus would be the center of all that is said and done, that they would be a light there in Oakboro and in the surrounding community. Lord, that people would come to faith in you, that they would just experience your goodness and your love through that fellowship. God, I pray that they would be a people that stand upon your word and that you would just equip them for every good work that you have for them. And God, as you work there at First Oakboro, God, I pray that we would celebrate your hand. Lord, that we would recognize that it's not about our individual church, but it's about the advancement of the kingdom, that we are partners together with local bodies in ministry. God, I thank you so much for the sister churches that you have placed around us. God, I just pray that your face would shine upon them, Lord, as we ask that your face would shine upon Bethel. As we continue to worship you this morning, Lord, just direct our hearts, our focus, and our thoughts toward you. Lord, be glorified through our worship. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
I wrote this song about three weeks ago, I think. Showed it to the band 2 weeks ago, and we've come up with this. But this song is about how when we choose to go our own way, it's a wide way. And a wide way is not always a good way. We talk about how following Jesus is a narrow pathway. And I think like that can be seen as a bad thing, but when you don't have all these other obstacles in your way, as you would on a wide pathway, it just makes life so much easier. So this is the way.
Going to sing Lord I Need You. And as I look at those lyrics, man, that was such a good song. Yeah, because we all want our own way. We always seek our own way, and it's just such a humbling thing to read those words on the screen and like have it right in your face of, man, we need the Lord, right? So I think this song is a great one to follow after that, because we need the Lord every hour to follow his way. So we could go ahead and start that song, please.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you. What sin runs deep, your grace is more. Grace is found, is where you are. Where you are, Lord, I Jesus, you're my hope. defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
If you have your Bible this morning, turn to the book of John. We're going to be in John chapter 6 this morning. John chapter 6, as we continue along, just to catch us back up to speed a little bit where we've been the last several weeks. John chapter 6 begins with a miracle where Christ feeds well over 5,000 people. All right, remember, a crowd had gathered around Christ. They were listening to him teach. He was healing people who were sick in the crowd. And it was supper time, and his disciples said, Jesus, you may want to send them away. Where are we going to get enough food? And they tried to come up with rationally, on their own, how they could provide food for this large crowd. Jesus already knew how the provision was going to be. He took 5 loaves, biscuits, pancakes, small pieces of bread, and 2 fish, not large fish, but they were like sardines. They were small fish. He took those and multiplied them to where all of the people ate until they were full. They were satisfied. And there were 12 baskets of leftovers. Last week, we saw that just after this, the disciples were weary and tired. As we looked to Matthew and his account of this story, we know that Jesus sent the disciples away. He sent them to the other side of the Sea of Galilee over toward Capernaum because they needed rest. And Christ stayed there on the eastern side of the Sea of Galilee for solitude and prayer. All right, remember that the disciples, they got in the boat and they went and they encountered a storm. They were fearful. They were afraid for their lives as the waves were crashing around them and the storm was wild. Jesus started walking to them on the water. They didn't recognize him at first. They were probably overwhelmed by their circumstances to where they didn't recognize Jesus, their Savior, their rabbi, their teacher that they had followed for well over a year. They didn't recognize him as he came on the water. They thought that it was a ghost, is what another one of the Gospels tells us. But Jesus said, "Don't be afraid, it is me." Jesus got into the boat with them. And John's account says that immediately the boat went to where they were traveling. We look back to the other Gospels that said that all in the boat worshiped him. Some of the lessons that we learned from last week's text is that storms in our lives are inevitable. But God is in control. Jesus is greater and more mighty than the storms in our lives. Not only that, but Jesus comes to us in those storms. So we have Christ with us when we face life's difficulties and storms. Also, we saw last week, we wrapped up, that our storms have a purpose. All right, the disciples who were in the boat, they worshiped God. They probably had a different perspective of Jesus after that storm than they did before. So there are times where the storms in our lives, God desires to use them to grow and strengthen our faith, to build a testimony for us to be able to speak to his goodness. That leads us into today's text. I'm going to throw you a little bit of a curveball. I want to read to you for context, John chapter 2, beginning in verse 23. All right, and then we'll flip over to today's text in John chapter 6. If you would stand with me as we read God's word this morning, again, nothing magical or you know, really effective in us standing. It's just an acknowledgement with our hearts that we are hearing from God's perfect and holy word this morning. So our context passage, John chapter 2, beginning in verse 23. "Now when he was in Jerusalem at the Passover feast, many believed in his name when they saw the signs that he was doing. But Jesus, on his part, did not entrust himself to them, because he knew all people and needed no one to bear witness about man, for he himself knew what was in man." Jesus knew the heart of mankind. Leads us over to today's text, beginning in chapter 6, verse 22. The day after the storm. On the next day, the crowd that remained on the other side of the sea saw that there had been only one boat there, and that Jesus had not entered the boat with his disciples, but that his disciples had gone away alone. Other boats from Tiberias came near the place where they had eaten the bread after the Lord had given thanks. So when the crowd saw that Jesus was not there, nor his disciples, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum seeking Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you are seeking me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. For on him God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to be doing the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." Let's pray. God, I thank you for your word this morning. I thank you for just the deep truths that we are going to encounter in this text. God, I thank you that you sent your son Christ. I thank you that Jesus is always sufficient for the needs that we have. But God, I pray that your word would speak, Lord, that it would challenge us. Lord, that we would consider how and why we seek Christ. Lord, that you would convict us of areas that need change in our lives. God, I pray that this would not just be an ordinary time in your word, but that you would use it to transform us. Holy Spirit, speak, help us to be sensitive and receptive to you. In Christ's name, amen. You can be seated. So here in this text, we see that there's a little bit of a transition after the storm. So the story of the storm and the disciples traveling across the sea is in the middle of the feeding of the 5,000, and then Christ, and where he begins to teach and explain in verse 22. For much of the rest of chapter 6, we're going to see where Christ explains. He gets to the heart of the matter in what the feeding of the 5,000, the truth that was there, how we should see and respond to Christ through that miracle. All right? We're going to see in today's text that crowd who had gathered, the crowd many who had been fed that day before, they missed the boat. They didn't see Jesus Christ for who he was. So beginning in verse 22 and following, we have where Christ unpacks and explains the miracle, the feeding of the 5,000. Verses 22 to 24, it just gives us context. So that next day after the storm, the day after the feeding of the 5,000, there are crowds that start to come back to where Jesus was when he performed that miracle. The crowds had seen the disciples get in the boat and to start traveling across toward the west, there to go to Capernaum. They saw that Jesus didn't get in the boat with the disciples. So they returned to where Jesus was, but they realized that Jesus wasn't there. So there's some confusion. They're wondering, okay, well, we saw the disciples leaving the boat. Jesus wasn't with him, but he's not here now. So what's going on? So they get in their boats and travel westward across the Sea of Galilee to Capernaum. And there they encounter Christ. We see in verse 25, it says, when they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi," which means teacher. They said, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" They were trying to understand Jesus. They were trying to figure out, okay, making 1 + 1 = 2 in their brains. They said, "We know what we saw, but this doesn't compute. What's going on? Jesus, how did you do what you did?" We see beginning in verse 26, just like when Nicodemus came to Jesus. All right, when Nicodemus asked secretly at night, saying that, you know, hey, we recognize that God is with you. We recognize there's something different and special about you. Jesus kind of ignored that statement, that question, and went right into, you must be born again. All right? We saw the truth that the spiritual birth is a miraculous birth that comes from above. Right here, Jesus does the same thing. He kind of skips over their question. You may ask, well, why did Jesus skip over their question? Well, it goes back to John chapter 2 that we just read. It said Jesus didn't need anybody as a witness to the heart of man because Jesus knew what was in the heart of man. So they're asking, they're saying, hey, how did you get here? When did you come here? But Jesus knows what their hearts are really asking. So Jesus starts to dial into the true heart issue of this crowd. We see in his response in verse 26, Jesus answered them, truly, truly, I say to you, you are seeking me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. This crowd was more concerned with the hand of Jesus than the face of Jesus. All right, and this is a difficult place to be because I think when we're honest with ourselves, we're in that boat with them as well. They weren't interested in hearing the truth that Christ was the Son of God. We're getting ready to see as Jesus unpacks and explains a little bit more in the next verse. Jesus had come to tell them about eternal life, about reconciliation with God, about peace that was possible with God, how he was God's plan for the redemption and salvation of mankind. But they didn't get it. They didn't recognize that Jesus came to be the sacrifice for their sins. They saw Jesus as a gift giver. They saw Jesus as a miracle performer, somebody who was there for their benefit. Jesus had fed them and they ate their fill and they were content. They enjoyed that picture of Jesus. Jesus knew that's why they were seeking him out. Jesus begins dialing into the fact, saying, hey, instead of seeking my hand, instead of seeking what I can do for you, you should seek me. Again, that's a hard place to be because in church, it's hard to draw that line of distinction sometimes between a relationship with Jesus and how he and God are active in our lives and some of the blessings we receive and, you know, as we see him at work. But if we're not careful, we can be tempted to look to Jesus for the things that he can do for us instead of looking to Jesus, period. You may say, well, I mean, that's kind of splitting hairs, isn't it, preacher? Well, maybe a little bit, but not really. Because when we seek Jesus for what he can do in our lives, what is the focus there? We're seeking him, but for our benefit. That's it. We are looking for the benefit to us to where we're the focus. All right, Jesus is our genie in a bottle. Jesus is the one that we can go to improve our situation. All right, to make my circumstances better, to provide for me when I'm in need. Can Jesus do those things? Absolutely. Absolutely he can. But there's got to be a balance there, and we have to have things in the right perspective. I want us to think just a minute about some of the dangers and implications of seeking Christ's hand, what he can do instead of his face. Think about things that you desire, that you pray for in your lives. If you pray for restored relationship, if you pray for financial blessing, if you pray for provision, if you pray for, hang in here with me, if you pray for the results of an election, oftentimes if we seek Christ's hand and not his face, when our prayers are not answered the way that we desire, the way that we see fit, the temptation is to say, well, Jesus didn't answer my prayer. To where then it would be quick and easy to turn our back on Christ because we didn't get what we wanted. I pray that this morning's text and this message, God would use it just to transform our perspective, that we look at our circumstances and we look at the way that we pray and the desires that we have. Because when we seek Christ's hand, when things don't go our way, we are quick to be finicky. We are quick to dismiss Jesus when we're really only in it for ourselves to start with. Christ realized that with this crowd. He said, you didn't come because you saw miracles. You didn't come because, you know, God's glory is being displayed here for you. You came because your belly was full and you were satisfied. And now it's the next day and you're hungry again. You've come back for more food. You are seeking me for what I can do for you. It's a very dangerous place to be, but I think it's a place where the church can settle into far too easily. We see in verse 27 where Christ starts to get to the heart of the matter. What Jesus is going to teach and explain about seeking him. All right, this is the first main truth in this text that I want us to see today. All right, this first teaching of Christ in verse 27, Jesus instructs this crowd as he kind of puts them in their place about their motives in seeking him. Verse 27, Jesus says, do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. For on him, God the Father has set his seal. So in this text, we see three things that either about Christ or that he instructs us to do. And I want us to go backward through them. All right, so the first that we see is that God set his seal upon Jesus. What does that mean? You know, I mean, that's kind of weird. What's that talking about? How can we understand that? All right, we know that Jesus is fully God. All right, he, in essence, the same makeup, the same character is God. All right, God in the flesh, God the Son who came to dwell here on earth. It's hard to reconcile and come to grips with that Jesus was fully God and fully man at the same time. But God placed his seal on Jesus. I think some verses from chapter 5 will help us to understand God placing his seal upon Christ. Remember, after Jesus healed the man outside the pool at Bethesda, when he was being questioned by the Pharisees, this was Christ's response in John 5, beginning in verse 19. Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, the Son can do nothing of his own accord, but only what he sees the Father doing. For whatever the Father does, that the Son does likewise. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all that he himself is doing. And greater works than these will he show him, so that you may marvel. Here we go. For as the Father raises the dead and gives them life, so also the Son gives life to whom he will. For the Father judges no one, but has given all judgment to the Son, that all may honor him just as they honor the Father. Whoever does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. So we see just right here in giving life and the right place in judgment, the Father has given over to the Son. We see that it's like God's affirmation. God is saying, hey, yes, this is my Son. This is the Messiah. He is here with purpose. So Jesus says, again, the Pharisees and the crowds, they had a hard time putting Jesus on the same plane, the same level of God, recognizing his equality in deity. Jesus says, but the Father's, he's placed his seal on me. That should give us a confidence as we seek Christ, knowing that he is God's plan and that God is with Jesus. The second thing that we see here in this text, Jesus instructs, he says, do not work for food that perishes. All right, a lot of times we can be fixated and focused on things that are temporary. Praying for our comfort, praying for our provision, praying for illnesses and sicknesses. And okay, listen, is it wrong to pray for those things? No, not at all. We should pray that God would provide, that Jesus would provide. We should pray for people who are sick, that they would be healed, that they would be better. But even more than that, I think that we should have a perspective that prays Help us to have a perspective that whatever happens, God, you desire to be glorified in that circumstance, and that the results don't determine how I respond to you. Matthew chapter 6, 19 through 21, Jesus gave instruction about not working for food that perishes. Jesus said, "Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal." Listen to this one. "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." This crowd, where was their treasure? Their treasure was in the benefits that they could receive from Jesus. Because their treasure was there, that's where their hearts were as they were seeking Christ. But Jesus teaches and says that the things of this earth, they're temporary and they do pass away. They don't bring lasting fulfillment. And that goes right into the third point that Jesus says. He says, so in the text, the way that it's worded here, I want us to look at it real quick. It says, "Do not work for the food that perishes, but for." All right, the verb there is understood from the first phrase. Do not work for the food that perishes, but work for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. Jesus is saying, hey, don't come to me and seek bread and fish. You should recognize and realize that I am able to give much greater than bread and fish. I can affect a lasting change on your eternity. As Jesus teaches these truths and encourages these people to shift their perspective from the here and now and the provision that they desire to seeing Christ for who he is, we see how they respond in verse 28. "Then they said to him, 'What must we do to be doing the works of God?'" Oh man. I don't know about you, but a lot of times I find myself in the same boat as these people. Jesus teaches them the truths of seeking eternal things, a bread that does not perish. We're getting ready to see who that bread is next week. All right, but to seek things that are above, that are eternal, not temporary, and not just physical needs. So the crowd says, okay, what do we need to do? Step by step, help us know what we need to do so that we can please God. Don't we always want an easy button? Don't we always want a list or a set of criteria that we need to do to please God? All right, to follow Jesus Christ. We want easy action steps. You know, there are times where I can think in my past with my grandfather, he would tell me, hey, I want you to go in to do this in the garden or on a lawnmower or a piece of equipment, you know, and he would kind of leave me to figure it out. And I would say, well, tell me what to do. I wanted step-by-step instructions. I think a lot of times we want step-by-step instructions because it gives us a bare minimum of what's needed. Tell me what I need to do and nothing extra so that efficiently and quickly, for my own convenience, I can figure this out and I can work it out. That was the mindset of the crowd here. They were saying, what do we need to do? Give us steps. Tell us exactly what's required. Because we as people want low commitment. We desire to do enough to get by and skirt by. So I think just if we understand the heart of man, as they ask this question, what do we need to do? They're really saying, what's just enough to get by? You know, just enough. We want to cross over that line, but we don't want it to require very much commitment or sacrifice. A lot of times in the church, we can be tempted to do things in order to follow God, or in order for him to be pleased, or for him to bless our church or our own lives. We have a mindset that defaults to rules, steps. What do I need to do? What is required of me? Jesus is getting ready to turn that on its head. That is a dangerous place to be as followers of Christ when we reduce following to steps and rules. We see Christ's response to the crowd as they say, okay, we hear what you're saying, but what's required? What do I need to do? Give me steps. Verse 29, Jesus answers. Jesus answers them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." Jesus right here says, hey, it is not about doing, but it is about believing. All right? This chair right here. I could stand here for the next 1,000 years and say, I believe that this chair is going to hold me up. I believe that it's strong enough to hold me up, and that if I sit in it, I won't fall to the ground. I can on and on and on till I'm blue in the face make that intellectual acknowledgement of that chair. To make that affirmation of, yeah, I believe this chair will hold me. But until there comes a point in time to where my belief affects my action, I can stand here and it's of little effect. But if I say, I believe that this chair will hold me up, then I put my trust in this chair. I've acted upon what I stated that I believe. So when Jesus calls this crowd, he says, hey, it's not about what you can do, but it's about believing in me. That's the work of God, for you to believe in the one whom he has sent. It's not a belief like we read about in John chapter 2, where the crowds at the Passover, they saw miracles that Jesus did, and it said they believed in him. But remember that tragic verse that says Jesus did not entrust himself to them? It was a belief that didn't lead to salvation, all right? It was an entertainment. It was maybe an intellectual acknowledgement, but it was not an effectual belief in their lives. Jesus says, should surrender yourself to who I am. It should lead to belief. True and genuine belief in Jesus Christ should produce us seeking Jesus' face and not just his hand. Believing in Jesus Christ, coming not for our bellies to be filled, but to see that he is the Messiah, God's perfect plan of redemption that makes peace with God possible, who is the giver of life, it should produce within us treasuring Jesus. Not just looking to him for what he can do for us. It can be a hard place to be. We may think and say, well, I mean, if we're seeking Jesus, aren't we already doing pretty good? Well, Jesus tells this crowd, if you're seeking him for the wrong reason, you're not really seeking him for who he is in truth anyway. Church, it's easy for us to want to reduce following Jesus to a set of rules or steps or action points. It's easy for us to default to, what's the minimum I can get by with, or what do I need to do? How can I work out and work toward following God? But when we realize that Jesus came, I'm telling you, come back next week. Continuing along in this passage, we're gonna get into some glorious truths that are some deep waters. But when we recognize that we on our own can't do anything to bring about salvation, but it's God's plan of redemption for mankind through Christ, when we believe and place our trust and surrender our lives to Jesus Christ, then it's at that point that Jesus transforms us. It is at that point that our lives will be forever changed. And prayerfully, at that point, we stop seeking the hand of Jesus, and we start seeking his face. Practically, how does this make a difference in our lives? I think one way that this text, this lesson of seeking the face of Christ instead of just his hand, I think one way that it plays out is in the way that we pray. I don't know if you notice or not, but I do pray for people who are sick. And I think that we should. But I try to direct my prayer to God in this situation, be glorified and make Jesus known. All right, when I pray that for others, it might be easier than when I pray that for myself. If I'm in tough circumstances or a storm in my life and I desire comfort, when we come to Jesus seeking his face and not just his hand, our prayers would transform from, Jesus, get me out of this situation and make my life better. Help me move beyond where I am now. But I think if we treasure Jesus Christ, our prayer would be, Jesus, thank you that you are with me in this storm and that it has a purpose and that you want to be known. Help me to sense how you're at work. Help me to make much of you and point others toward Jesus Christ in the middle of this storm. Friend, I'm not standing here saying that that is easy to do. It's hard. It is difficult when it comes down to our comfort or our pain or grief, the things that we face. But I think when we see Jesus for who he is and not looking directly toward what he can do, it'll change our perspective even as we pray. I think that when we seek Christ's face instead of his hand, another area that it will change our perspective is within relationships, within our lives. You know, a lot of times we want to fix it. There are times where I will give my kids instructions or tell them to do something, or like I mentioned, my grandfather telling me how to work on the lawnmower. He could have come and shown me how to do it. Would have been easy for him to do. But do you know what? Through my struggle, I learned. Through my struggle, there was more ownership in being able to carry out that task. It's the same way with my kids. I can say, hey, I want you to fold the laundry, and then go and show them how to fold every piece. It might not always be the best thing relationally. We can pray for others. We can walk alongside them. But I think we need to be careful to recognize that in struggle and trial and difficulty, there can be much growth and that God could desire to use it in our lives and in the lives of others. So we see that it can change our prayer life. It can change our relationships. One of the biggest ones I think it'll change is our joy. Because when we seek Jesus' hand, when that's the direction of our prayers and the desires of our heart, when things don't go the way that we want them to go, we are not going to be a joyful people. We might grumble, we might complain, we might be frustrated, we might question God and his goodness. But when we seek his face and we say, I trust how you're at work in this situation. I don't understand it. I may not even like it, but I trust that you've got a plan and I trust that you are who you say you are. Then I think that we can face difficulty and struggle and trial with joy. And as we do, believe me, the world is going to take notice. Not for our credit, not for our benefit, not to where people will say, hey, man, let me tell you about that person. No. But to where hopefully the world would say, whoa, what a difference Jesus makes in people's lives. Church family, I want to encourage us as individuals, as families, as a local body of believers. I want to challenge us to try to transition, to be refined by God's word, to be molded and shaped to where instead of seeking what Jesus can do in our lives, seeking the face of Jesus and trusting that he is who he said he is, and that he's at work, and that he has a good purpose and a good plan. This crowd missed the boat when Jesus fed them. They were amazed, but they were happy that they got some free food. And Jesus says, there's so much more to it than that, because I can give you eternal food, eternal life. Remember the woman at the well? When Jesus asked her for a drink and she started talking about the water, and Jesus said, well, if you knew who you were talking to, you would ask me for a drink. Because if you drink this water, you'll thirst again. But I can give you a water to where you will never thirst again. That's what Jesus is saying here, using food as the example. Jesus is good. Always. Jesus has a plan. Always. Jesus desires for us to seek his face instead of his hand. Always. God, I thank you for your word. I thank you for the challenge that it brings. God, there are so many areas in my own life that I am guilty of seeking your hand and not focusing on your face. Lord, forgive me. God, I know as a people and as a church, there are many times that our perspective is off. We're so easily able to be satisfied with focusing on ourselves and just asking you to work in our lives to make them better, to make them more comfortable, to give provision and bring provision that we need. God, to pray for healing, to pray for our nation. God, those are all good things to pray for. They are things that we should pray for. God, we should pray for those who are sick. We should pray for upcoming elections. But God, we should do it with a perspective that you're in control and that we can trust that you have a good plan, and to seek how you are at work. God, for us to desire to make you known and to make much of Jesus Christ, no matter the circumstances we face. God, this is not easy. Lord, we need you. Every hour, we need you. In this time of commitment, this time of response, Lord, I just pray that you would speak through your Holy Spirit into the lives of men and women and boys and girls who have joined us today in worship, that we would be sensitive to your Spirit as he speaks, that God, we would be transformed by the power of your Spirit and by your word. Lord, grow us to be a people of joy, a people with a right perspective on relationships. Help us to be a praying people. Help us to be a people that love your word. Help us to be a people that love you and love Jesus for who you are, because you are good and you are beautiful. Holy Spirit, I pray that you would speak into hearts now for this time of commitment, that we would respond to you in obedience and in faith. In Jesus' name.